I want to welcome everybody here tonight in the name of the Lord. Amen. Amen. I believe that tonight your life and our lives will never be the same again. We are here to declare the kingdom of God. Amen. Amen. To this land of Durham, to heal the sick and to cast out devils. Amen. Amen. And to learn about the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Are we here tonight?
Amen.
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 I'm excited. Yesterday's word was extremely powerful. Amen. I believe that as we go, we're going to find that woman at the well. Amen. And we won't come across that Amalekite that will lead us to completely take over this land. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. So we'll ask the praise and worship team to give us some praise. Amen. High praise that will shake the foundations of this land. Amen.
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 Are you tired?
No.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's rise and praise the Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
this atmosphere, this vessel. I ask that every word will come from your throne. I pray for divine utterance. I pray that you possess me by the power of your spirit. And that you will have your way tonight. And as I minister here as a king, as a priest, with the imperial anointing of God, that your kingdom will come and become an entity in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to hear a big hallelujah.
Amen.
You have a shout in your mouth. Shout hallelujah. For joy. Is that not so? So every fabric, every cell, every article, every molecule comes out of the realm of praise and worship. Amen. That's why we are created to praise Him. The Bible says that everything that has breath, praise the Lord. And your praise has power to bind princes. Your praise has power to break principalities. Your praise has power to execute the judgments of the Lord. The Bible says, in the mouth of sucklings and babies, thou hast ordained strength and praise to steal the tongue of the enemy. Amen. Today, as we have praise, as we have worship, the principality over Durham is broken. The principality of drugs is broken. The principality of crime is broken. I want to hear a bigger amen. You see, your shout has something to do with executing the will and the purposes of God. Amen. Yeah. Bible says that when Israel surrounded Jericho, went around that city, how many times? Seven times. The wall didn't come down the first day. The wall didn't come down the second day. The sixth day, the wall was still standing up. The seventh day, the wall was still up. But when they began to lift up their voice and they began to praise and began to shout, the Bible says the walls came down. There are certain walls that are hindering, obstructing, and limiting your life. But when you begin to shout, there will come a breakthrough in your life. As you begin to shout, that spirit of crime in this area, that spirit of amakia in this area is coming down. I want to hear a big shout of praise. Shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. Shout unto God with a voice of praise. I got to sing over this place. I want you to believe that God is up to something in this land. Amen. Durham has been known all over the United States as a place where there are homicides, murders, and all kinds of stuff going on. Amen. It has always been in the minds of people as a murder city. But I noticed that in the course of time, other cities in North Carolina have taken over that mantle. Because we have it here. But there is still a lot of work that has to be done. Amen. I was reading an article just this evening before coming over. It says violent crimes, including homicides, are up in Durham, according to the latest crime report. This is in 2016. You know, most of these rates comes after the year is ended. You understand that? So let me just read this, if you don't mind. It says, violent crime is becoming more common in the Bull City. And the police chief is concerned things will get worse in the short term. Interim police chief Larry Smith outlined the crime statistics from the first quarter of 2016. He found that violent crime increased by 7% compared to the same time the year before. This includes a 10% increase in homicides. What can be done? We are going to keep doing what we've been doing. We've all put our resources that we have into it. We have officers in these areas where it is happening. The issue gained more attention last week after a series of shootings. Two of them were deadly. And let me go down a little bit. In this same article, they recall this. Do you see things getting any better? Asked Donald Mayor Bill Bell. Larry Smith told CBS, North Carolina, he's doubtful they will in the short term because the underlying causes of the violence in the city are not changing. All right, so it goes on and on and on. But the main thing I noticed was that the city is doing everything they can to resolve the problem. What they've been doing is trying to beef up the police presence in the city, getting a jail system in place, a prison system in place. But how many know that is not the solution? Solution doesn't come from the natural realm. Solution comes from heaven. In heaven, there's no shootings going on there. In shootings there, in heaven, you don't have prisons and jail systems. You can't solve the problem, so you lock people up like animals. And you throw the key away. And they come out of the prison system worse. And many of them, when they come out, they can't stay out. Within a short time, they'll go back into their prison. I want to put to you that the prison system is not the best way to solve the wave of crime in North Carolina. I'm here to offer you a better way. Hallelujah. See, you need to understand that unless the people of God rise up against the demonic forces behind what is happening, nothing can take place. You can buy more guns for the police. You can come up with all the various ideas and stuff. But until God stretches out his hand, nothing can happen. Until God came down, Israel was stuck in Egypt. But after a number of years, God said, I have come down to redeem my people from the hands of the Egyptians. And he sent just one man and he brought all of Israel out of that danger. I'm here to announce to you that your father has come down to bring a resolution and a solution to this crisis in this country and in this land. A lot of this crime is fueled by the drug activity. In fact, the president is being asked by a lot of the law enforcement efforts to announce the opioid crisis as an epidemic. There are entire cities and counties where people are dying from ODing on these opioids. Heroin and synthetic drugs. Now the heroin, they mix it up with, is it fentanyl? Fentanyl, right? They mix it up, they cut it out with some stuff and it just boosts the heroin, it makes it worse. And a lot of these guys doing this have not been trained. So when they cut it out, at times the dosage is too much and somebody takes what he thinks he can handle and it knocks him out and he ends up in hell. In certain cities, almost every house, somebody has died from being, you know, overdosed on this issue. My brother and sister, today I'm here to announce to you that we have a God in heaven. Amen. Who is here to solve this problem. Amen. The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against wicked spirits in heavenly places. And so our weapons are not fleshly or carnal, but they are mighty through God, even to the pulling down of strongholds. We are here to pull down strongholds. Amen. And this stronghold of pharmacia or the drug activity, I announce to you, is coming down. We have the power to handle this situation. Yeah. The Bible says that to them that received him, to them gave he what? Power to become children of the living God, or sons of the living God, even to as many as believe on his name. So when the disciples came to Jesus, he gave them power over all unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Say, I have power. How many have received Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior in this house? Have you received Jesus? The moment you receive Jesus, God gave you power. Amen. God gave you power over all unclean spirits to cast them out. God gave you power to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. And God expects you to put that power to use. Now, when God gives you power to deal with a situation, He's not going to come down and handle what He has put in your care. And there are many Christians in Durham, North Carolina. There are many churches in Durham, North Carolina. And still the crime rate is going up. There are prayer meetings going on. There are church services going on. And still the problem is persistent because you cannot handle a demonic power that has a royal crown on its head with a church anointing. A church anointing can only handle problems within the church. Bible says that the priestly anointing is given to priests to handle and to deal with sin and to handle things pertaining to the house of God. But God has also raised up another office called the office of the king to handle issues outside of the house. Can I hear a big amen? Amen. And this is the office of the king. Oh, yeah. And so in Revelations 1, and I want us to read that, Revelations 1, verse 5 and 6. Many people think they are just priests. You are also a king. God has made you a king. When Jesus died on the cross, He died to wash your sins away. But that wasn't the only thing He did. He did much more than washing you from your sins. There was a reason why He washed you from your sins. There's a reason why He died on the cross. He died to prepare you to become what? A king. So let's go to Revelation 1, verse 5 and 6. Are we there? And I'm reading it from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins. Say, I'm washed.
I'm washed.
Hallelujah. The blood of Jesus has washed us from our sins.
Amen.
Jesus has washed you from your sins.
Amen.
The Bible says that God commended His love for us, in that whilst we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So Jesus died in your place. Amen. The Bible says that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having been made a curse for us. For it is written that cursed is any man that hangeth on the tree. So Jesus took your blows for you. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was laid on Him, and by His stripes we are healed.
Amen.
Our sins were laid on Jesus Christ, and that's where we end everything. Say, Father, touch me right now. Hallelujah. Say, Holy Ghost, open my eyes to hear this word in Jesus' name. Now, the church ends with verse 5, but this train of thought doesn't end in verse 5. The Bible continues to say that after Jesus washed us from our sins, He has made us. What has He made us? Kings and priests. Read that again. I want to hear your voice. Verse 6. And have made us kings and priests unto God. To whom we want glory and dominion forever and ever. Say, have you made a king? And a priest. Now, were you made a priest first or a king first? You've been made a king first. So your kingship is your primary assignment. Your kingship is your first office. And God is a God of order. He's not a God of confusion. And when God sets something in place, you have to keep to His order. When you mess up with the order, there's a mess in your life. So the Bible says, seek ye what first? The church. Is that what it said? It says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and then all these things shall be added unto you as well. So when you begin to seek your kingship and begin to seek what God has put in your life as a king, the Bible says that things that you were struggling for, things that you were chasing, things that you need in your life will be naturally, gravitationally drawn towards you. When you become a king, and when you begin to think the way God thinks about you, that you are a king first and then a priest, your life will come into order. Your household will come into order. Your marriage will come into order. Your children will come into order. Your city will come into order. I'm telling you, the kings are rising. Because what the priests can do, only the kings can do it. God created these two offices for two different purposes. He created the priest to handle the affairs in the house. But to go out and to handle the business outside, it will take a king. Let's come at the end of time when the natural son will not be the Sarees. Amen. It will not just be Sarees. You will see a mother and a child just walking on the streets. You see children riding their bicycles on the streets. Can I hear a big amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. No more natural curfews. On Friday, we had an all night. We have been praying all night with the prayer team in the church. And after we're done praying, we dismissed everybody. And then I got in a car with me and my wife and my daughter. And I said, let's go to where the crusade grounds are. Let's go and pray around the place. But we drove and we came down. We started to drive down. We went down Elizabeth Street. When we got there, almost where Angia Avenue meets up with Elizabeth, we had gunshots. Pow, 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 pow. 5 shots, and then there was a pause. Pow, pow. 7 shots. I was like, oh, we have run into something here. And there was a policeman that was patrolling that area, the car. And the car stopped. And I saw the policeman was kind of thinking through the whole issue. Because he's the only person who is there. Nobody has called it in. And then he turns his car and goes in the direction of where those gunshots were made. Somebody had just been shot. Somebody's life had just been blocked. Somebody is not going to grow old and see their children and all that kind of stuff. Somebody is dead. Right there, at the very moment we came here to pray, that brought all this hope to me that we got to do something about it. If our prayer meetings could have solved this problem, Dora would be the safest place in town. If our church services could have solved this problem, it would have been solved by now. Because we are not doing what God has given to us. The power you have is first manifested in your kingly office. And when you begin to walk in your kingly office, you can handle that problem. Because the devil has a kingdom, not just a church. You see, we think the kingdom is the church. It's not. The kingdom comes first, and out of the kingdom comes the church. The church is birthed out of the kingdom. Can I hear a big amen?
Amen?
So when Jesus came to the earth, the first message he preached is repent, for the church is at hand. Is that what he said?
No.
He said repent, for the kingdom of heaven. Now don't think I'm a Jehovah Witness, so I'm not a Jehovah Witness. Amen. That is a cult, and that is a doctrine that is just wrong. It's not of God. Amen. But Jesus preached the kingdom of God. He said repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. 55 times in Matthew alone, the word kingdom is used. Only 3 times in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, is the word church mentioned. He only mentioned the church when he was done with his kingdom business. As he was wrapping up his activity, he says, Peter, I'm going to give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. You see this? I'm going to give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. He says, and I'm going to build the church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. So after establishing the kingdom, he said, you tear this temple down, and in 3 days I will build it up. Is that not what he said?
Yeah.
And then thought that he meant Herod's temple. He said, this temple has been 46 years in building. How can you tear down a temple like that and build it back up in 3 days? But he was talking about the temple of his own body. And the church is the body of Christ. Is that not so? And so when he hung on the cross, the Bible says that 30 pieces of silver had been paid for him. Are you aware? And in the Bible, the price of a woman in the Old Testament is 30 pieces of silver. Jesus died for you. And when I see him on the cross, blood and water came out of his side. The church was born. But before the church could be born, the kingdom had to be established first. Because the devil is not a pastor. He's not a bishop with a collar, amen, or a staff, a shepherd's staff. Satan has a kingdom. He said, I will exalt my throne above the stars of heaven. Satan has a throne. Revelation 13 says, he gave his seat and his power and authority to the Antichrist guy. So he has a seat, he has a throne. In Matthew 12, Jesus said, If Satan cast out Satan, how can then his kingdom stand? So he has a kingdom, and you are coming against him with a church anointing. You cannot face him. You can only face a kingdom with another kingdom. It takes a government to unseat another government. God has given you the government of the kingdom, and he has sent you to go and cast out devils. Amen. And these devils have different realms of authority. There are devils that live in human beings. Amen. There are devils that actually govern families. There are devils that also govern cities. And there are devils that govern nations. When Daniel was praying for 21 days, the Bible says the prince of Persia came and withstood him for how many days? That's a prince. What is a prince? That is a royal term. That's a royal personality, right? And it took 21 days to break through that demonic force. Today we are going to break through. There are principalities operating over this city that we are breaking down in this service. Can I hear the amen?
Amen.
We are breaking down the principality of the crime activity and the drug activity. And today you're going to join with me to bring this principality down.
Amen.
Amen. You see, we think that the power we have to cast out devils only deals with devils in people's life. No, it's more than that. The Bible says that when an unclean spirit is cast out of a man, he walketh to dry places seeking rest and finds none. Then he says, I will go to my house where I came out from. And when he comes, he finds an empty strength and garnish. He said, I'm going to go. I'm going to get some seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And he comes in and he dwells in that house. And the Bible says the state of that man is worse than the first. And then Jesus says, so shall it be to this generation. So there are devils that can occupy human beings, and there are devils that govern entire generations. He says, what I'm saying to you about this man is also to be applied to a nation. It can also be applied to a generation. There are generational demons. There are demons that find a location, a place, and a generation to dwell in and manifest their character. That is why in some cities, you will see that certain demonic activities are peculiar to that city. If you go to Atlanta, you have transsexual stuff going on there. Is that not so? If you go to South California, it's homosexuality. If you go to Las Vegas, it's what? Gambling. Many lives have been destroyed at the gambling table. If you go to some cities, it's alcoholism. In some places, it's opioid crisis. In Durham, it's a crime activity. And I'm here to announce to you that we are here with a solution for this problem. The crime activity is going to come down because we say so.
Yes.
The Bible says, where the word of a king is, there is power. And who can say what doest thou? When a king issues a decree, it cannot return to him void. God sitting on the throne, what does he sit on? He sits on what? A throne. That makes him a king. And the Bible says that when I release my word, it will not return to me void, but it will accomplish the purpose for which I sent it. And I'm releasing a word in this environment. I'm releasing a word from this house. I'm releasing a word from this place, not as a pastor, not as an evangelist, but as a king with kingly anointing and with an imperial anointing. And I declare to the principalities and to the powers that your time here is over. We are not here to come and placate. We are not here to compromise. We are not here to allow you to appease. We are not going to appease you. We are coming against you.
Yes.
And we are casting you out,
yes,
in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
The Bible says, if I, by the Spirit of God, cast out devils, no doubt, the kingdom of God is coming.
Yes.
So the kingdom, when it comes, devils go.
Amen.
Because when heaven comes down, whatever is not aligned, whatever is not synchronized with heaven has to be moved out of place. I say heaven is being synchronized with Durham, North Carolina. And whatever cannot manifest in heaven is being removed out of place. every drug activity cannot manifest in heaven. So when heaven comes down, drug activity shall be exposed. Drug cartels shall be exposed. Drug lords shall be exposed. We're going to see a dismantling of drug cartels right here in Durham, North Carolina. We're going to see the crime rates being reduced in Jesus' name. The young men and the young women shall begin to walk in our streets and be safe from being shot at in the mighty name of Jesus. Whenever we turn on our TV and hear our people being shot, we are here to announce to the principalities it is over. Your time here is over. We have a decree from the ancient of days, and we are saying that as Moses said to Pharaoh, let my people go. Let the young men go. Let the young women go. Let our children go. Let the drug addicts go. Let the prostitutes go. Let the drug lords go. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says, I give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever you bind on the earth shall be bound in heaven. I bind the crime activity in Durham, North Carolina, with the keys of the kingdom of heaven. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is bound. It is bound. It is bound. And the Bible says, whatsoever you loose on the earth shall be loose in heaven. I lose the kingdom of God in this place. I lose the power of God in this place. I lose the glory of God in this place. We are the kings with supernatural power to stop demonic activity, because we don't have power from just the second heavens. Our power supersedes any power from the second heavens, because when Jesus was raised from the dead, the Bible says he was raised far above every principality, far above every power, far above every might and dominion. And the Bible says that you and I have been raised up together with him. And together with him, we sit in the third heavens. We actually outrank the princes. God made you a king so that you can outrank the prince. The prince is a lower rank than the king. So God makes you a king so that he can then give you charge to go take out that Goliath. We are taking out the Goliath of drug activity. When God began to send out the disciples, he said, when you go, preach, say, the kingdom of heaven is where? At hand. Heal the sick. Cleanse the lepers. Raise the dead. Cast out devils. Freely you have received, freely you must give. This power that God has given you is free. Jesus has paid a price. For you it is free, but for Jesus he had to pay for it. And this is power to heal the sick. We have power to heal the sick. Not just to heal the sick, but also cleanse the lepers. That is incurable diseases like cancer. Amen. Diabetes, high blood pressure, tumors, growth, things that you just have to be medicated and you have to live with it. God says in heaven, you don't live with that. So when heaven comes down, you no longer have to live with that infirmity. We have seen various people heal from high blood pressure. We've seen people heal from diabetes. We have seen people heal from all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. There was a man who went to pray for. According to the doctors, he had cancer. That's what they said. I said, no, he does not have cancer. Bible says that a divine sentence is in the lips of a king.
Yes.
The Bible says that his lips does not transgress in judgment. So when the king says that there's no cancer, then there's no cancer. Later they checked it, they found out there was no cancer there.
No cancer.
No cancer. Now if we had not spoken, if we had not released a royal edict, the opposite would have happened.
Yes, yes.
But because the king spoke, the cancer had to go away.
Uh-huh.
And we are decreeing over Durham that also the principality of infirmities, the principality of cancer, is dying right now in Jesus' mighty name.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Cancer is a spirit.
It is.
And you have power over unclean spirits. And today I exercise authority over that spirit of cancer that is harvesting souls in this land. And I declare that cancer is being eradicated. My spiritual father was commissioned by God to eradicate cancer from the whole world. God gave the possibility like 7 years ago, a divine order, a divine mandate to tear that principality down. God said to him that cancer is the main principality or strong man over the whole land of America. When something is a strong man, it's not the most powerful, it's the wisest. This is the spirit that says, I'll go and get 7 other spirits more wicked than himself. So this strong man doesn't necessarily have to be more powerful. He's the one that has the strategy. And he's the one that has the keys. You understand that? And the Bible says, you strike the shepherd, the sheep will scatter. So when you're dealing with unclean spirits, what do? You must find out the strong man. And when you knock out the strong man, the rest of the devils that came with him also have to go. So as cancer has been eradicated, as cancer has been defeated, after the other unclean spirits of infirmity also are going. I heard news very recently that in Israel, they came out with a drug, a vaccination, and they can inject you with that vaccination. It's on the news. They can inject you with this vaccination, and it has the ability to attack the cancer cell. So it will use your own cells to attack any cancer cell. So when you are a healthy person, then if ever that happens, it will help you to overcome it. And then if somebody already has cancer, this drug will actually empower your cells to discover those cancer cells. Now, you see, cancer is a spirit. Say, cancer is a spirit. It's not just a condition, there's an evil spirit behind it. You know, and I read and I listened to this news, and it was saying that when you begin to attack the cancer cells, it begins to release certain strange things to deceive the cell that are attacking it. It will begin to, you know, mask itself and go into disguise inside the body. That is why people are giving chemotherapy and radiation, and after some years, the thing comes back up again. The thing goes and hides itself somewhere. And when they have destroyed your immune system, and when all your red blood cells have been destroyed, and you are defenseless, then the devil comes out and says, here I am. Then within a short time, bam, they take that person to the hospice. We are dismantling this false spirit. Because the apostle have done this spirit, now drugs are coming out. And the FDA is trying to stop these drugs from coming out. But as we are here, we are saying that is no more. God himself is coming down to stop FDA. And all these drug guys, this particular drug, they say that now they have to take it through all that tests and go through all that things to get the patent. Whilst people are dying. So isn't this drug better than chemotherapy? Isn't this drug better than radiation? Eh? You want to tell me that poisoning somebody's entire body with a toxin is better than this particular thing? I'm telling you that God has a solution. All this that you are seeing, the blaring of the horns, that is the devil trying to fight this way. But I'm telling you that he's been defeated. That is just a sign that he's been defeated. That's just a sign that he's been defeated. Because you can't win this battle. Because the Bible says, all this from above is above all. Heaven is above all. And when heaven comes, it rules. Crime is coming down Durham, Carolina. I'm announcing to Durham, your streets are going to be safe to walk in. You can rise up at night and say, I'm going for a walk. I'm tired of just being at home all the time. I'm walking. And you'll not have to be worried. You'll not have to go with a pepper spray. You'll not have to go with a pistol. You'll be safe on the streets. I'm announcing this to you. It's only kings who talk like that. Priests will say, let's go and pray about this. This is going to be a tough one. We have to go into fasting and prayer. A king says, it is so, and that's it. When a king speaks, that's it. Kings have authority to handle things that are not in the church. They can go outside the church and stop things that are happening outside of it. You see, Samuel was a priest. You all know that, right? And it was Samuel who was the judge of Israel for so many years after Eli died. And after so many years, because he was a church, the Philistines couldn't come into the land of Israel. They couldn't be defeated either, but they couldn't come into Israel. But then Samuel grew old, and the Philistines became more restless. And the people of Israel came to Samuel, and they said, Samuel, we thank God for how he has been using you. Right now you are old, and your children are terrible pastors. Your children have been taking bribes and fooling around like your spiritual father Eli. So your children are behaving. Because Eli had sons who were also very wicked. They were stealing money and were sleeping with women in the church. Isn't that wickedness? That is wickedness. They said to Samuel, you need to appoint us a king who will go ahead of us and fight our battles. And we are tired from having a defensive posture. You see, priests, they are defenders of the house. See, when you have a church, it is a city of refuge. When you go inside the church, when you go inside the house of God, you are in a house of refuge. The avenger of blood cannot follow you into that church unless it is not of God. If that church is of God, the enemy can't follow you into that building. Are you understanding this? But the enemy will just wait for you outside. Oh yeah, that was that church activity, you will have to come out. Unless you're doing a shout, you're going to stay shouting all day long. You will have to come out. Amen. And then we'll just deal with you then. So the devil has a way of outwitting people. He knows that he can't come inside the church, but he can operate in the city. Where is the church? It's in the city. So only thing you can do is to defend and have a hedge around your life. But God didn't create us to just have a defensive posture. Have you heard that the best defense is offense? Is that not so? So I need you to understand this thing. They came to someone and said that we're tired of just priests fighting off the enemy. We need a king. That will not just defend us, but now we'll go to where the enemy is, step out of this place and go out with an army and confront the enemy in his own city so that we can be safe here at home. So whilst you and I are here today, there are our brothers and our sisters are out there in Afghanistan. They are out there in Iraq. They are out there in South Korea. They are out there all over the world. There are so many army bases, U.S. Army bases all over the world. Have you seen a shotgun fight in America? It's only those guys who broke through on 9/11. You know that? But what country has been able to bring war to our shores? Because we have a soldier or we have armies outside fighting our battles. Well, you have your kings working, your house is safe. Today I'm here to announce to Doran that kings have been anointed to come outside of the house and handle the problem in the city, the problem in the county, the problem in the whole state. And as we are here as kings and priests, we are bringing about a change. Hallelujah. Now I want you to mark this word. Find out what the crime rate is right now. And next year when we come here, tell me what the crime rate is. And I'm telling you that you will discover that because we have been here in this room, and because we have joined forces together as kings and priests, that this principality is coming down. Yeah. The only sound that principality will respond to is a royal sound. Because it is a royal. It takes a royal to confront another royal. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh, glory be to God. Amen. I'm going to give you one last scripture and we are going to pray. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm excited this night. Are you excited? Amen. Because we are not here just to worry about a problem, but to solve it. Let's go to Luke 11. Luke 11. See, the strong man is coming down. The strong man of darkness is coming down. Amen. You're going to see leaders of gangs getting saved. Are you listening to me? You're going to see leaders of gangs dropping their guns. Jesus will start appearing to them in their dreams. That is what is going to start happening. Many of our young men and young women are going to say, I don't know what made me get into this gang. I'm out of here. And the actual leaders who nobody knows about, the big guys who hide in their nice jobs and who are actually financing the whole thing, God begin to expose them. If they don't repent, God will expose them. They're going to see, is it Crips and Bloods or whatever they call it? There's coming a judgment from heaven to stop that kind of activity. Are you afraid of this kind of talk? I'm telling you that we are kings. It's not the Bloods or the Crips that is the problem. It is the spirit behind them that is the problem. And they are actually captives and prisoners of this foul spirit. If they were not held captive, they would give their lives to God. And today we are coming against that foul spirit of sorcery. Sorcery is traps that is holding their lives hostage and prematurely ending their lives. And we are saying to this young man and to this young woman that Jesus loves you. That he died for you. He died to make you a king. Not to be a king over a gang. That's too small. He's making you a king to rule over a kingdom for all of eternity. Isn't that better? It's time to drop your guns down and accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. Otherwise, if you don't repent and you continue on this activity, something will happen to you. I speak to the drug lords. I speak to the leaders of these cartels that you need to let those young boys go. You need to break those covenants. You need to come out of that situation. Otherwise, God will find you where you are. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
We are bringing order to this city. Can I hear a big amen?
Amen.
Can I hear a big amen?
Amen?
Let my people go. There are young men and young women that want to come out of these gangs, but they can't. Because of the covenants they've entered into. Because of the pledges they have made. Some of them have been harassed into becoming members of this gang. But today we say that God is coming for you. You are coming out of these gangs in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And you are going to become kings and priests. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You don't have to die early. We destroy that spirit of death in Jesus' name. Are we in Luke 11? Are you there? Look at verse 20. But if I, with the finger of God, cast out devils, is that in your Bible? Am I reading with the Bible? But if I, with the finger of God, cast out devils, no doubt the kingdom of God is come unto you. What is the kingdom of God? It is God's sovereign rule, power, and authority that has come down from heaven to the earth to take over. It is the realm of heaven, or the way things are done in heaven, being brought down to the earth. The gospel message and the good news of the gospel is that whatever is in heaven has come down right here. All you have to do is believe the gospel and the kingdom will manifest in your life. And I announce to Durham that God's sovereign rule, God's sovereign power, God's sovereign dominion has come to this city to take over and to rule in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Look at verse 21. God begins to reveal what a strong man is. When the strong man armed, keeping his what? Palace. His goods are in peace. But when a stronger than him shall come upon him and overcome him, he taketh from him all his armor wherein he trusted. And what does he do? He divided his spoil. So a strong man is also a principality. And principalities, they work in the children of disobedience and they execute their will through children of disobedience. And principalities are called in the Bible strong men. In the spiritual realm, if you are to see them, they are muscled and they are big and they are strong. They are giants. You understand that? Amen. When you read in the Old Testament about giants, God was actually giving us a picture of what we are dealing with in the spirit. Can I hear a huge
amen?
Jesus called them strong men. Number two, they are armed. They have weapons. And they are watching over their palace. Their palace can be a human being. Their palace can be somebody's household. So you see that in a certain household, all the people in that house or in that family have the same problem. What is that? There's a strong man ruling over the house.
Yes, yes.
They have children, they grew up, and they have the same problems. If their father divorced, they also divorced. They have children, no matter how good they are, still they divorce. Because there's a strong man in the house. But we are coming against that strong man in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Some people, their family, they all have cancer. When they hit the age of 45, or the age of 46, or the age of 50, then they come down with a disease. We are coming against that strong man of infirmity. Amen. And that strong man, his palace can also be a city. It can also be a country. It can even be a continent. But thanks be to God that Jesus Christ, when he died, he went to hell. And the Bible says, he took captivity captive. He spoiled the principalities and the powers. And he made an open show of them. He has triumphed over them by the cross. The cross is a kingdom strategic move to transfer power from the hands of Satan into our hands. Can I hear a bigger amen?
Amen.
Paul says that when a strong man arm, he keepeth his palace. So these devils, their main business is to ensure that the souls that are in their grip stay in prison, that they are not going to experience any prison break. So their main job is to ensure that you never have deliverance. They want to ensure that you never be free. But thanks be to God that Jesus says, when a stronger than he shall come upon him and overcome him, he taketh from him all his armor wherein he trusted and divided the spoils. Today we are coming upon this principality of sorcery, the drug activity. We are coming against the spirit. There was a city called Samaria that had this problem of sorcery. Sorcery is not just witchcraft. It also includes drugs. The word sorcery in the Greek is pharmakia. Pharmakia is what? Drugs. Drugs. So drugs is in the Bible. And this spirit had gripped the whole city called Samaria, so that everybody in that city was sick. They were either paralyzed or they were lame. Can you imagine, you go to a city, almost everybody is limping? That's a terrible oppression, isn't that so? But God sent a deacon. Just a deacon. He hadn't been staying in the church long enough to be a pastor. He was just a deacon. The job that he had in his previous church was waiting on tables. He's a guy who brings food, you know, the hospitality department. But I've read in the Bible, 1 Timothy 3 verse 13, that those who have exercised the office of the deacon purchase unto themselves great boldness of faith. So when you become a good servant, God gives you more power. This deacon went into Samaria. And the Bible says he preached Jesus Christ. And he preached the kingdom of God. And as he preached, the Bible says that devils began to come out of people, crying out with a loud voice. And those who were sick were getting healed. The lame began to walk. Those who were bound by devils, the devils came out of them. And the Bible says there was great joy in that city. There was great joy in that city. And the Bible says that before this time, there was a man called Simon the sorcerer that had bewitched the entire city to the point where they thought that he was the power of God. Meanwhile, he had bewitched them with sicknesses and diseases. We come against the principality of witchcraft in North Carolina. We come against the occultic powers in this land. We have received power to tread upon serpents. We have received power to tread upon scorpions. We have power to tread upon all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by enemies hurt us. We break the occultic powers. We break the witchcraft powers. We break the wizardry in this land. We break the powers of the occult. We break the Freemasonry spirit in this land. We break the powers of darkness, the diplomacy in this land, the psychic activity in this land, the familiar spirit in this land. We exercise authority over you. We bind you with the keys of the kingdom. And we banish you from this land. We cast you out of this land in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bible said there was great joy in that city.
Yes.
Everybody, that thing was broken off their life.
Amen.
As this world is going now, that thing has been broken off your life.
Yes.
I feel the freedom in the air.
Yes.
I feel that this thing has been broken.
Yes.
How many can feel what we are talking
yes.
about? God is setting you free. God is setting your family free.
Yes.
And God is setting the whole city free.
Yes.
Hallelujah. all God needs is somebody to come into the heart of the problem and to be a representative of heaven and say, my son, you speak and I will confirm your word in heaven. You bind on the earth and I, Jehovah, will bind those powers in the heavenly realms.
Yeah.
You lose on the earth and I will ensure that what you lose is also loosed in heaven. Yeah. And we are here as a representative of heaven. Mm-hmm. And we are saying that this man is free.
Yes.
From drug activity.
Free.
And you know what? According to these guys who are still in the drug problem, they say that where poverty is, that's where these drug activities are more pronounced. Mm-hmm. Think about it. If these young men and young women, if they go to Walmart to work at Walmart, how much are they going to be paid? Number one, they are not going to be given enough hours to make a living. Mm-hmm. They are going to have to be on welfare. They're going to have to be on food stamps just to make it. Are you all getting me? The pay is too small. Now, if this young man has a good job that pays him well, that is respectable. God, the Bible says that every man is crowned with glory and what? Honor. There's glory and honor. So every man has honor. They want to be honorable. It's not honorable to be walking about with a gun in your pocket and shooting up people. It's not honorable. Any man in their right mind will never do that. But because they've been taken over, they will do that. But what if God releases a business into Durham? And so many businesses come into Durham that they are begging people to work. And they are saying, we'll pay you $20 an hour, $25 an hour. We'll give you all the hours you want to work. What if 10 of these companies come into Durham, North Carolina? You think these young men will go around shooting themselves up? Well, what are we going to do? We're going to open up the realm of heaven for jobs to come into this house. For jobs to come into Durham, North Carolina. For the poverty in this land to be broken. Have we gone down Elizabeth Street? Have we gone down to some of these areas? In America, some of these houses are horrible. Many people were born in poverty and died poor and raised up children who only knew about poverty.
Yes.
But today we are coming against the spirit of poverty in Durham, North Carolina. In heaven, there's no lack. In heaven, there's no need. In heaven, the streets are actually paved, I believe, with gold.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So in heaven, the street is gold. Then what do you need of money? So in heaven, you have all that you need. So Jesus, according to Paul, says, my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Bible says, all the silver is mine. And all the gold is mine, saith the Lord God of hosts. And as a king with imperial anointing, I decree that jobs have come to North Carolina.
Amen.
I decree that the economy is being revived. I tap into the spiritual inheritance of Elijah and the spiritual inheritance of Elisha, who could in one day change the economy of a nation and say that tomorrow by this time, the economy will be healed. And
yes,
the very next day, the economy was healed.
Yes.
I decree that this economy is being healed right now in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I decree by the Spirit of the living God,
yes,
that Durham is receiving an economic rejuvenation, an economic revival in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The economy of Durham is being healed. Companies are transferring and coming to Durham, North Carolina.
Yes.
If you want to go to church on Sunday, they will let you go to church on Sunday. They are going to see companies that will not even open up on Sundays. Am I in this house? If jobs are coming, they will come with divine order. 6 days you work, 7 days you rest. That is divine order.
Yes.
When the stronger than him shall come upon him and overcome him, he taketh from him.
Yes.
All his armor wherein he trusted. And divided his spoil.
Divided
the spoil is number one, souls. Mm-hmm. The souls that they are bound, we have commanded them to come out. Jesus said, Father, glorify thy name. And the Father says, I have both glorified it and I will glorify it again. And then Jesus said, this voice came not for my sake, but for your sakes. Now is the judgment of this world. Now is the judgment of Durham, North Carolina. And now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Now shall the prince of Durham be cast out.
Amen.
And if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. These were the men that were under that prince. Now we are saying that Jesus is Lord. Can you raise your finger and say, Jesus is Lord?
Jesus.
Just say, Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Say, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. Are you a king?
Yes.
Since I am a king.
I am a king.
And a priest.
And a priest.
In the kingdom of God. With the imperial anointing. I have governmental power. From heaven.
From heaven.
Over all unclean spirits.
Over all unclean spirits.
To cast them out.
To cast them out.
I have power from heaven.
I have power from
to
heaven.
All manner of sickness.
And all manner of disease.
When I command a devil to go,
it has to go.
When I command a sickness to go,
it has to go.
Where the word of a king is,
there is power.
And we can say, what do we start? As we lift up our right hand, hallelujah. Say, we come against a principality of sorcery, of drug activity. And we come against you in the name of Jesus.
We lose
the kingdom of the living God
to confront
every drug activity, every drug cartel in the name of Jesus. And we bind the forces of darkness ruling over this city. We break your hold.
We break your hold.
I want to give God a major shout. As a king and a priest in the kingdom of the living God.
Yes, Lord.
And I come against the spirit of death and premature death that has been harvesting the lives of the sons of Dorum. We said this far you will go and no more.
Yes.
I decree unto you with a royal decree that your hold, your grip over this city is now broken.
Amen.
You no longer have the souls with infirmity. You no longer have the souls with drug activity. You no longer have the souls to the murder activity or homicides. We come against the spirit of death and hell. I put you on notice, thou foul spirit, that Jesus Christ shut you down and he took the keys from your hand and he took the keys of hell. And now the keys of death and hell are in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as a king in the kingdom of God, I take hold of the keys of death and hell. And I command the souls that are bound in the stronghold of death, in the room of the future death, to be transferred from death to life. I transfer souls from darkness to light. I transfer the souls bound by drugs, bound by drug activity, bound by poverty, bound by the spirit of death, bound by infirmities, bound by cancer. I transfer you from the powers of darkness and from the authority of Satan into the kingdom of light, into the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to make this decree. Say, the kingdoms of North Carolina,
the kingdoms of North Carolina,
the kingdoms of Durham,
the kingdoms of
Durham, have become
the kingdom
of our Lord, and of his Christ, and Jesus shall reign, and Jesus shall rule. In the name of Jesus,
you are the Lord. You are the
Just believe. All things are possible to him that believe.
Amen.
If only you believe, the kingdom of God is here. That growth is disappearing right now. It is disintegrating right now. That tumor is drying up right now. It is drying up right now. That diabetes is gone. It is gone. It is gone. High blood pressure doesn't exist in your body anymore. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is speaking imperially that all sickness is gone. Divine health is in this house. You will live and not die. And you will live to see the goodness of God in the land of the living. I speak life to your eyes, to your ears. I speak all that to your body. I command that sickness to leave. I command that back problem to be healed right now in the name of Jesus. There's somebody who has a spinal problem. Even as you're watching, that problem in your back is being healed right now. That problem with your disc, God is causing it to be properly aligned right now. God is bringing healing into your body right now. Hallelujah. Someone with a knee problem, as you were singing, your knee was replaced. Hallelujah. Your knee was replaced. I hear hip replacement. I say hip replacement. Somebody's hip has just been replaced. In the glory, in the glory, every problem is resolved. Something with your hand, with your feet, whatever you were having a problem with, try right now, see if it is gone. Have an issue with your shoulder, just do your arm like this. Hallelujah. Come, come, let me pray for you. Lord, come, amen. This is one of my dear brothers, amen. He came and married one of my daughters.
Isn't God so good? Think that the passages are opening up right now.
We seal this blessing in Jesus' name. Our flesh will not arise the second time. He that the Son sets free is free indeed in Jesus' name. Any other person before we leave tonight? Hello, my sister. It is so good to see you. Yes. You have a way of checking when you go home. It's going to happen. Amen. I want us all to stretch our hand towards our sister. God is not happy when his people, his own children, are sick. He's never happy about that. But today, God will bring solution. Father, I pray for your handmaid. I thank you for her faith to come out believing. And I decree that according to your faith, it is so done unto you. Diabetes is leaving this body right now. High blood pressure, I bind you in Jesus' name. Come out and go with every breath. I command a new heart organ for you, a brand new heart organ. I command your cardiovascular system to be healed. I command your blood pressure to be normal and to remain normal. 120 over 80 in Jesus' name. I command the blood sugar levels to normalize. I thank you, Father, for the healing power flowing through her. Thank you that she is healed in Jesus' name. Amen. Every spirit of infirmity is broken. And I command it to leave you right now. You will leave and you will see good days in your life. In Jesus' name. When I was praying for you, what did you feel? You feel what?
I feel the same.
You don't feel the same. You feel different. See, the Lord has healed you. Is it God so good? I decree to you that you are healed. You are healed. Go to a doctor or whatever, check yourself out, and you will see that that problem is no longer there. And this will show you that God is here. Hallelujah. Isn't God good? God is healing his people. He is healing his people. He's healing you. He's healing everyone. He's